Hey.
About cook daily. How did that start? I became a
vegetarian.
From?
Do you know that? So just think, all of this year I was still dealing with meat, proper like, yeah, proper savage in the kitchen. Loved it. I loved every part of.
What was your favourite food? What was your favourite meal? That your comfort food.
One of my favourite was in Spain. It was pig's feet.
Ah, okay.
Pig's feet, quite stewed, quite gelatinous.
Mm.
I used to love bone marrow. Mm. In St. John's. Yeah, just quite hardcore foods. Old, classics, traditional, awful. Yeah. See, that's what I'm trying to say.
Of course, because but I'm Jamaican, so this, all this
yeah.
stuff means stuff to
yeah,
me.
Yeah, so you know, yeah, like, oxtail, cow foot, whatever.
Yeah,
you get
cow
me?
Foot,
like,
yeah.
Just, yeah, I mean, I grew up with world foods, but then, yeah, like, I used to eat all of that stuff.
What was that vegan point for you?
At first, it was vegetarian. Mm-hmm. I became a vegetarian in 2009 after watching a documentary called Earthlings.
Okay.
And just before I had my son, I was just prepping myself for fatherhood, you know what I mean? Me and my wife for parenthood. So we started meditating. We started taking courses at the London Buddhist Centre in Bethnal Green. And they just helped us in making that right choice of giving up meat, man.
Were you Buddhist before or not?
Yeah, I was born as an ethnic Buddhist, but okay. I really started practicing in my early 20s.
Okay.
So that was it. That was a turning point of trying to figure out life, trying to be more happier. What was all this about, man? Working all these hours, chasing a dream. You know, now I'm back in London. I realise that I don't really have nothing in common with these chefs. Do you know what I'm trying to say? I'm from a different place, different background, all of this stuff. I was still trying to find myself. So I was on a quest. So vegetarianism was a part of that journey, that quest, you know what I mean? And then 4 or 5 years later, 2014, I became a vegan. Mm. Do you know what I mean? And that was it. I've never looked back since. That was the best thing, one of the best things I've ever done in my life.
So what was the switch point from vegetarian to vegan?
Just a lack of knowledge when you're a vegetarian, to be honest with you.
Okay.
And then when you get into this lifestyle more, you start learning about different things, you know what I mean? How bad milk is for you, you know what I mean? How much mucus it creates in your system, etc., you know? Just loads of things, and it just started making sense, and I just took that leap, and I did it, man, and the pounds dropped.
How heavy were you?
No, I've always been heavy like that, it's just puffy.
Okay.
All the eggs and butter, can you imagine? Like, eggs fried rice, boiled eggs, omelettes, butter, croissants, all of that stuff. It's just fat, do you know what I mean? And cholesterol. I cut it out, and I was just lighter, man. Just lighter.
You look good, man.
Thank you. Hope I do. Go back to vegetarian. Seriously, man. I just felt so much better. The energy was high energy levels. My intake of fruit, was just shot up. I just ate so much fruits every day. Green smoothies, all of that stuff, man. Mm. Plant-based milk, you know, no more cow's milk. You know what I mean? Like milk from nuts and seeds, you know.
How long did it actually take you to adjust? I know you were a vegetarian before, but the cutting out the dairy part of it entirely, how long did that take you to adjust, and when did you start to really feel the benefits of transitioning to a full vegan diet?
I'd say straight away, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I was on a vegetarian diet for quite a while anyway. As soon as I cut out the dairy and the eggs, I just felt it straight away.
Mm-hmm.
Almost like instant clarity in my mind also, man.
Did you miss anything though?
Of course. Of course. But after that, that just dies. You know,
yeah.
I mean, that just passes like a cloud. You know, you're just there. I just notice it and be like, okay, well, that smells quite pleasant.
Mm.
You know, maybe like a bacon sandwich or something when I walk past a calf. Oh, it smells quite pleasant. Or I can brainwash myself and be like, yeah, that's swine. So that's what I do now. I just kind of be like, nah, that's swine.
That's why.
That's blood and bone. Like, that just stinks. Like I need some clean fried food at least. You know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you guys use quite a lot of the what do you call it? The kind of
seitan vegan chicken.
Yeah.
What are you talking about?
Yeah.
Man. I love that stuff. So that's made from soybeans and wheat protein, and it's a bridge also for people. You know. Because
mm-hmm.
We're not denying, especially me, I'm not denying that, you know, chicken tasted good. And all these other products tasted good also. It's just, I've just realized now that I don't really need that in my life, you know what I mean? I don't need blood on my hands for me to thrive, especially now in London, 2018. I mean, you look at all the supermarkets now, get anything, vegan cheese, vegan ham, vegan sausage rolls, vegan milks, it's all there.
Mm.
All the major supermarkets, it's all there.
Mm.
And it's there for a reason, man. It's for us to make that transition, because that's the future.
There has been like a 70% uptake of people going vegan and vegetarian. What do you think is the reason behind people suddenly making that decision to
us, the youngsters, mate? Yeah.
Mm.
It's all in our hands now. So you see, like Shoreditch, they call this the capital, the vegan mile, the capital of veganism in London. And it's just like there's about what, 10-15 restaurants around just Shoreditch.
Mm-hmm.
It's the people, man, and they're getting younger and younger. Do you know what I mean? I mean, if you look at my following, I've got a lot of people following me that are young men, yeah, young and out of home, you know, don't have access to their own kitchen, but they can learn things and they can get inspiration. So it's the younger generation too, man, because they are the future. So these companies know that, you know, they're not targeting people over their 50s. Do you know what I mean?
Mm.
It's the younger generation. So that's what it is. It's the people.
So you think, so because of your reach with like young people, you get a lot of collabs. So you've done Adidas, you did a BBK thing, didn't you? Involved in that.
Yeah.
So how do you see your kind of your food and the kind of the culture thing? How do you see that mixing in the future?
Do you know what I wanted to do? I just wanted to normalize veganism. You know what I mean? And me alongside JME, that's what we want to do, man. We just want to make it look, we're this person, we do this, we live this lifestyle, mm-hmm. but we're also vegans. Do you know what I'm trying to say? We're not like, it's not 1989 anymore, you know.
Mm-hmm.
We're not white men with dreadlocks in a field with flowers in our head, you know. It is what it is. It's like we thump grime, we listen to grime, we do this, we play Street Fighter, and then we eat plant-based food.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? And that's what we wanted to create with Cook Daily. So we did that, man, and now you have a Cook Daily culture, which is Cool Daily culture just means everyone and everything,
mm-hmm.
but one thing in common, we like to eat Cool Daily food, which is vegan.
Okay.
And it's vegan for a reason. So if they do their research, they'll know, you know, it's all about the animals, it's for the animals. Mm-hmm. Vegan, no blood, no bones, red graffiti, spray paint, it means something, you know what I mean? And that was from the beginning, that was in 2015, mm-hmm. you know, and to this day you still have other restaurants that don't even want to use that word, you know, they rather use plant-based, you know.
Yeah.
So pretty things like that, which is cool. But with me, I just knew it. Nah, this is what I'm pushing. I'm pushing vegan, no blood, no bones.
Mm-hmm.
Unapologetically. That's it. I always get mixed up.
Well, you got me that Spanish word, so I can get you that one. But let's just dial it back a little bit, because you say that becoming a father changed how you ate and how you thought.
Mm.
Like, explain that to people who aren't even parents or who aren't even close to it. What was it in you that at that stage that just said, I've got to make a change?
It's weird, isn't it? I mean, you know, you're a parent, so it's like just preparing your life for the next chapter, man. You know, you're going to bring another human being into this world. I'm not going to be a part of Coca-Cola and McDonald's and KFC, even though that was my upbringing. Do you know what I mean? But I knew that was a load of crap now. So it's about making change, and all I did was make a big change,
mm-hmm.
you know, a massive change. And now they are the future, man. They're so vegan. They're so hardcore vegans, my children. It's incredible.
I take it you don't even have to.
No,
you
don't, I don't.
You have to influence them much.
No,
they
not
just,
at all, man.
It's just
they influence me.
Life. Yeah.
Don't tell me. I think yesterday I saw thin slices of Oreos. And we stopped eating Oreos a while ago because it had palm oil. But I thought, you know what? Let me get my kids to experience this. You know what I mean? The thinner version, you know, different textures.
Mm.
And Indy, my daughter who's four, she was like, no, I'm not doing it. It's got palm oil. It's got palm oil.
God.
So I thought, oh, okay then. Do you know what I mean?
That's what's wrong with palm oil?
Just deforestation.
Okay.
Yeah, to get the palm oil in the jungle. Do you know what I mean? Loads of animals and wildlife just being damaged.
So it's a whole, it's not just. No, not eating animals, it's also caring about.
It just depends. It just depends. I like it's a journey.
Yeah.
My main thing is to stop eating animals.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if someone gave me a Oreo and I really wanted it, I'll just eat that. Do you know what I mean? But if they gave me something that had direct fish in it or something, nah, I'm not doing that.
Okay.
But anyway, to be honest with you, I'm avoiding palm oil. you know, as much as I can, and or other things that I want to avoid will just be like things like plastic more, you know what I mean, zero waste, all that stuff. So I think it's a journey, but to take it one step at a time, especially if you've got a family and especially if you've got other priorities, don't beat yourself up, you know what I mean? But what you can do is just stick to the basic, which is stop eating animals. That's easy.
Okay.
You've got choices, you know. Because we can talk about this whole lifestyle for so long, you know, whether exotic fruits is ethical because of the mileage and the planes, etc., etc. Look, let's stop eating animals first and then we can concentrate on the rest. And for me, it's my own journey, like everyone else, other vegan, you know what I mean? Some vegans are on it hard, which is, I respect that, but I live in the real world also, you know what I'm trying to say? And the real world is I have to survive on this planet with four other individuals, you know what I'm trying to say? So it's about being light as I can, but not beating myself up. If I if I decided to eat at a non-vegan place, that's fine, do you know what I mean?
Can I ask about your parents? How supportive were they when you decided to say,
well, when
no
I first,
mom, I don't want no pig feet?
it was a big shock to them, but they knew that I was on something, man. I was always searching for something else, so they knew. My father wasn't too happy about raising London up a vegetarian at the time. He would say like, oh, I don't mind you guys being vegetarian, but you know, maybe give him fish or something, do you know what I mean? But now, you know, fast forward 8 years later, geez, they proper love it. Yeah, man, they proper love their grandchildren being vegan. They probably tell everyone that, yeah, we're vegan, we're a vegan family now. They don't even touch eggs, they don't even touch milk. They're proud.
Yeah.
Because they know the benefits of it. They're not vegan themselves, but I definitely have had an impact in their diet and their way of living. My mum juices often now.
Okay,
you know?
That's good. Do your parents help out at your shop, at your restaurants or like?
Yeah, so my father, they're both retired, but they just need to keep moving. So my mum has the van and she just likes to go shopping for me and gets the stuff that I need. So she helps out with that, and my father too. So they just want to stay active. And when they're not in Laos, traveling back and forth, they're here helping me, bringing back loads of pea flower tea from Laos or something, you know?
Okay, yeah. I love that. I'd love the family.
Or lemongrass, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, loads of lemongrass all the time. From my mum's garden, actually.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
In Laos?
Yeah, in Laos.
Okay, it smells, I know we said it really, but it just smells, it's such a calming, smell. You just feel like you're somewhere else, isn't it? Yeah. So it's quite nice that you guys are, like, you started helping them and now they've kind of come to the stage in their life where they're back to helping you, and then your kids will probably kind of jump into that when they're young, when they're, you know, old enough to do the same thing. Where as a parent, what kind of ambitions do you have for your children?
I have this vision that I want them to live freely as possible. So just be creative as possible, you know what I mean? I want to get to a level where they don't have to worry about money or anything like that, you know, they can just live their life. Ideally, I want my son, when he's 17, to travel the world, I don't know, skateboard all around the world or something like that, you know what I mean? Rather than just being stuck here and applying for jobs in London and living this bullshit life that I see sometimes, do you know what I'm trying to say? Because I see a lot of unhappy people on the tube and it's like, it kills me, man. But some people got to do what they got to do, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't want my kids to go through that, I really don't. You know, some people say, yeah, but you know, you got to let them experience other jobs. No, I don't, man. I don't. I want them to be free.
But isn't the whole point is for us to be able to do better than our generation before us?
Exactly.
Yeah. So, yeah, no, I mean...
I actually want to travel with them, to be honest with you. Yeah, I want to travel... I want to live abroad for like a couple of years or something with them, you know? I did it as, you know, when I wasn't married, but you know, now that I've got a family, I'd definitely love to do that, man. Maybe like 6 months in Singapore, in Malaysia, something like that, you know? International school for the kids, something like that. Yeah, definitely.
How about Jamaica?
Yeah, definitely. I need to visit Jamaica. I need to visit Jamaica, India, Japan. They're all on my list, man.
Yeah, well, especially when one of... am I right in assuming that we're almost at Cook Daily?
Yeah.
That the high-grade dish on your menu is like one of the most popular dishes there.
Yeah, the high-grade is my signature dish.
Yeah.
At Cook Daily.
What was the inspiration behind that?
Inspiration is marijuana. You know, it was the ganja, man. Smoky, sweet and sour barbecue with hemp oil, stir fried with hemp oil, veggies, hemp seed crumbles, green herbs, all of that stuff. So the idea behind that was after I had Pringles, it was a barbecue flavor, and I thought, how could I create this flavor into a main meal? So I started experimenting and I came up with the high grade.
Okay.
And the whole theme was based around hemp.
Mm-hmm. So, I know you're a big fan of hemp. What does hemp do for us?
Hemp's amazing for you, man. It's got so high in protein. Mm-hmm. So anybody asking about where do we get our protein from, forget tofu, hemp. Yeah. Hemp, now hemp's amazing. Not just for your body, mm-hmm. Externally, but internally also. I use hemp oil on my face.
Okay.
Yeah. Cold press, hemp oil. Get it from the health food shops. You can actually cook with it. So anything that I can't eat, I won't put on my skin.
Okay, that's a good tip.
Yeah, so I'll put things on my skin. If I had to, it would be like olive oil, coconut oil. But I prefer hemp oil and moringa oil at the moment. Yeah.
Okay. Moringa is a big thing at the moment, isn't it?
Yeah, moringa, man. That's a miracle seed.
So you're also friends with Shaka, right?
Yeah.
How did that friendship come about?
You know what? So I was cooking for all these years. And then in 2014, when I became a vegan, I took a year out of cooking, of working. So I started training with Spartan fam, Shaka Bars. Mm-hmm. And yeah, man, we just built a great relationship since then, man. I would turn up and have my post-workout drink in my bag after a session. And then Shaka would see it and be like, yo, what's that? I'd be like, this is coconut milk, homemade, like cold press, mm-hmm. all of that stuff, raw, vegan. And he's like, oh, let me try. So he tried it. It's like, next week, can you bring me a bottle? So I did that. And then within a few weeks, I used to bring a mini suitcase to training.
Yeah.
That had about 30 bottles of vegan milks, and I would just shot them, and that would pay for my expenses of traveling and training. So that was it, man. And then I just realized that, wow, people actually want to eat and try my food, you know.
Mm.
I started Instagram, started posting my breakfast and smoothies on Instagram, and then people just wanted to try and eat and taste. So a year later, Cook Daily was born, man.
But you had that, is it Unit 54?
Unit 55 in the
55,
beginning,
yeah,
a single shipping container. So I opened that, and within a week we was established.
Okay.
So much support just came through the doors. It was overwhelming, man. So big up everyone that supported 3 years ago, man. It was sick. Mm-hmm. Such a sick journey.
And then you moved to your double unit now.
Yeah,
okay.
I've got a double unit now. And that's going. And then I'm working on...
That's going?
Yeah, that's going. So...
As in, we're going to move on?
Yeah, we're going to move on, man. The next chapter.
Whoa.
Yeah. A lot of people be like, yeah, King, are you doing this? You're doing that? You're doing a party? You're doing leaving this? My thing is, like, you got to learn to let go.
Yeah.
So it's like, I feel like I don't really hold on to things like this that much anymore. Mm-hmm. You know, I just like to let go and just let it die naturally.
Okay.
You know, like even with the single unit before and Cook Daily, or the other restaurant that I opened, the second one, which is home vegan Thai food, I just let that go, man. I didn't really hold on to it. I let it go and just done something new. So it's a continuation, you know.
Mm.
So that's the way I think about things.
I even feel away.
Yeah, I'm telling you, man. So like, oh, it's just like, that's done. Like, I forgot about Cook Daily here already. I'm thinking of the my next restaurant already, you know.
Okay.
150 seated restaurant around the corner from here.
As a Buddhist, you have to take some time to return to the temple, right?
Yeah, so as a Buddhist, Mao, you're meant to spend some time at the temple after the age of 21. So, and it's normally about a week. So I went back when I was 21 I was in a monastery for 100 days. So it was a 100-day retreat. And that was crazy also. That was such an experience. I went back, shaved my head, eyebrows, put my orange robes on, and just left London life, and just didn't have no possessions at all. No phone, no money, no nothing, and just stayed there for 100 days, learning about my culture. And Buddhism is a part of that.
Mm. So why did you do 100 days instead of what was required of you?
I just knew that a week I wouldn't learn nothing, do you know what I mean? And I wanted to change, you know. I just always wanted to change all the time. I don't know what it was. I was never happy with myself. So I thought, let me just commit to 100 days. And that's what I did. And my mum was shocked. She goes, are you sure you want to go for 100 days? So she took me there. We done the whole ceremony. And obviously she's not going to stay in Laos for that long, because she had a business to run here. So she came back and I was just there. And then she came back to pick me up, and you know, because we had to do a ceremony again of me leaving the temple. But That was cool, man. I did a lot of reading, a lot of time to myself, a lot of meditation, and I learned about Buddhism. Mm. And I learned that here we take everything for granted, man. Things like washing machines and dishwashers and stuff, you know. Over there I was washing the robes, these long robes, man, by hand, you know what I mean?
It was crazy. Was it just yours or was it everybody's?
No, just mine, but okay. I've never washed clothes with my hands, you know what I mean? I've always used a washing machine.
But you must have been an expert at the end of that, right?
Yeah, trust me. Felt like I was Jackie Chan, like twisting it, rinsing it, you know what I mean? It was cool though, man.
Yeah,
it was cool. I enjoyed it. I was young and I enjoyed it, and it was definitely needed. It took me back to my roots, you know?
Yeah.
And then I came back to London, and within a few months, went out the window.
Oh no!
All the zen went out the window, and it was back to the Cockney lifestyle again. Funny.
When you weren't fasting, how did you guys get food?
Alms round, which is walk along the village every morning with your begging bowl, barefoot, and just receiving the offerings that people give you,
mm-hmm.
and just having what they give you. You know what I mean? You have no choice really. Mm. You can't really say, oh, I want this, I want that. As a monk, as a practicing ordained monk, you know what I mean? There's rules to follow. I think there's like 208 precepts.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's crazy, man. It's really hardcore. Yeah, it is hardcore. Trust me. Just sitting in that heat, also, for all them hours meditating in the robe,
mm-hmm.
in Laos, one of the hottest countries in the world. It was insane.
I just
really had to be with the breath there. Trust me.
So you have to focus on your breathing.
Yeah, I wasn't even used to sitting down, my legs crossed for that long. Anyway, do you know what I mean? You know, from coming from the Western world. But I managed it, and I just realised, like, yeah, you really have to be with the breath, because when you're there chanting for over an hour or an hour and a half or 2 hours, and it's like, you know, it's boiling hot, you're in robes, there's no air conditioning, you really have to control your breath and just be with the pain, breathe into the pain, you know what I mean? Yeah. Whether it be a leg ache or an itchy back or anything, you know?
Yeah. I think any parents watching this who've like had a troubled teen or something like that can, it gives you inspiration, or it gives you kind of a knowledge that your child with the right leadership can, you know, come through it, and it doesn't have to be like a really negative story at the end of the day, because look at you.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, my son's seen the photos, he's heard the stories about Laos. We've been back to Laos twice already.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I just can't wait until it's his turn to spend time in a temple, and I'm going to do it with him, you know what I mean?
Okay.
So, just to guide him.
Mm.
It's good, man. It's good for a Lao boy to go through that, definitely.
How did your father feel about your experience there?
No, they loved it. I mean, it's something special, you know? To do that, you're doing it for your parents also. So that's the whole thing. It's like you do it for your parents. But what I found out later is she meant it for me. Do you know what I'm trying to say? It wasn't for her, my mum, really.
Okay.
Like, she's, you know what I mean? It was for me. So at that time, I didn't realise. I thought, yeah, I'm doing it for my parents, mm-hmm. and for myself. But really, you know, you now that I'm a parent, they mean it for you, don't they?
Yeah. Listen, King, you're exactly what my Carlisle Stories is about. You're about the ordinary guy who made that decision to do something extraordinary.
Yeah.
And it's here for people to see. And I hope that your story will inspire some kid who is just maybe struggling and just hasn't quite worked out what his passion is, just to be able to put in the work. And God knows, in 15 years' time, we could be hearing his story.
Yeah, I mean, that's what it's about, man. It's about inspiring the next generation and inspiring each other. Do you know what I mean? And you, what's next, man? When are you gonna jump on this vegan lifestyle?
On me. Listen, I'm considering it. I'm definitely considering it. So,
what's stopping you? Do you know? Do you have one thing that's stopping
you?
Chicken. Okay.
No,
is it really?
No, chicken's not stopping me. I think, you know...
Have you watched any documentaries?
I haven't watched any documentaries. I've watched some documentaries, and I have a good understanding of what's in...
Would you watch one if I was to recommend one?
Yes. Okay,
This is what got me... is what got me started in the beginning. So, Earthlings.
Okay.
It's quite it's quite graphic.
Okay.
But if you could watch it and connect, it's going to make much more sense of why people are on this journey.
Okay.
Earthlings, yeah?
Okay.
And that's for everyone watching also.
Yes.
Tune into Earthlings, and then, yeah, the journey begins.
I'm going to watch it.
Wicked.
Listen, so thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Have a hug. Thank you.
Bye.